Morning, church. Thank you, Trick and Carlos. This is my story. This is my song. Amen. Thank you, brother. Well, happy Thanksgiving. Hopefully everybody enjoyed their day. I know we enjoyed ours. Food was great. We actually had two turkeys. We had the traditional turkey, and then my brother decided we were going to fry one, and he was kind enough to let me put the bird into the hot oil. Of course, I burnt my hand. And then he tells me, well, you need to have stories like this for the holidays. Oh, okay. I didn't know I needed it, but now I know. We didn't burn the house down or nothing like that, though, so thank God. But it really tasted delicious, though. It was really, really good. But, yeah, the family had a good time. Hopefully you enjoyed your family and enjoyed the day. And I pray we continue to enjoy this time of year. I heard Sister Sandy, there's so many things, is going on, and I'm sure even in our own lives. But hopefully we'll just take the time and really just enjoy all these moments. Amen? Just enjoy one another and enjoy God. I'm going to jump right in, church. I don't have no wind up, but Mike told me he'll clean it up if I mess it up, so good. Then I'm not going to worry about it. But the title this morning is Empty, and I was in several passages of Scripture, but I'm going to start off with this verse here, Matthew chapter 12. Let's pick it up in verse 43. When the unclean spirit is gone out of the man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, and findeth none. Then he saith, I will return unto my house from whence I come out. And when he is come, he find it empty, swept, and garnished. So this unclean spirit, was just trying to find a place to chill. And sure enough, he found a place. He found this house, and it was empty. And said, well, fine, I'll stay here. And of course, as it goes on to tell the story, he says, you know what? I'm going to get seven more worse than me. And I'm going to really make a mess of this place. It's like Animal House. Remember the movie Animal House? This is Animal House right here in Matthew chapter 12. This is where they got the idea for Animal House. You see, the problem wasn't with the unclean spirit. There's plenty of unclean spirits. There are unclean spirits all day, every day, all over the place. The problem was the house was empty. Now, if the house was filled, then there would be no room for that unclean spirit. But it was empty. And so he made himself a nice cozy place, and he wreaked havoc on the house. And it says the condition of this person, the last state of this person was worse than the first. So it got worse because the house was empty. Now it was garnished. It might have been decorated pretty, might have had a nice tree, probably had a nice cross on the wall, probably said, Jesus loves me, little sign. It's garnished, but it's empty. And so therein lies the problem. And I think sometimes church, I don't know about you, but sometimes I do find myself empty. That old Jackson Brown song, Running on Empty? The truth is, most of our life is running on empty, and we don't even know it. We need a God that loves us to come along and to save us and to actually show us and to fill us. You got two choices. You can be empty or you can be filled. I choose to be filled. And of course, it's to hopefully be filled with the love of God, right? The love of Christ. I thought about that old hymn growing up. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread from heaven, feed me till I want no more. Lift my cup, fill it up, and make me whole. Unless the Lord fills our cup, church. Thanks for the few claps. I noticed my brother wasn't clapping. Unless he fills up that cup, it's empty anyway. But that's the earnest prayer when we say, Lord, fill me. You ever pray that prayer? Maybe it's a time like me, when I do feel empty, and I just pray, Lord, fill me. Lord, fill me. Like, take a look at Isaiah chapter 24. Maybe we'll open this up a little bit more today. But interestingly enough, Isaiah 24 opens with, as you might guess it, the word empty. We'll start in verse 1. Behold, the Lord maketh the earth empty, and he maketh waste. He turneth it upside down and scattereth abroad the inhabitants thereof. So here in this case, God's actually the one that empties the earth out. Like, can you picture, like, you know, God's massive, he's just taking the, you know, shaking it. You see, I think it was like his coffee cup, you know. He took a sip, he thought it was going to be sweet and delicious. He took a sip and it was salty and nasty. He said, he dumped that cup of coffee. You ever have a bad cup of coffee? Man, ain't nothing worse than a bad cup of coffee, man. You're going to dump that out real fast. And I think that's what happened here. I think God, he took a look at the earth and he said, man, this ain't what I didn't make this. And he, because he loves us, he empties out that earth. You got to see this through the loving eyes of God. He's not angry. He's not upset. He just knows that that's not the way it's supposed to be. And so he empties the earth out. And sometimes he's got to empty my earth out, church. Why? Because I put the wrong stuff in it. That's not how you make coffee. You ever do that? You go to the drive-thru, you order something, they give you the wrong order, and it's like, I didn't order this. Yeah, you got to see this through the loving eyes of God, and he is going to, and then he tells you right there in the second verse, well, who's he going to empty this earth on? Well, it says, it shall be with the people, so with the priest, and the servant, and the master, and the maid, and the mistress, and the buyer, and the seller, and the lender, and the borrower, and the taker, and the usurer, and the giver, and the usury. Listen, it's everybody. No matter what side you find yourself on, the giver, the taker. But again, the maid, the mistress. It doesn't matter. Wherever you find yourself, he will empty the earth on everyone. On everyone. Not just the church. The church may have an awareness of it, bless God. But whether you have an awareness or not, he's still going to empty out the earth. Because that's not what he created. And the truth is, we fill our earth up with some silly stuff. Sometimes it's well-intended, and sometimes it's not well-intended. Again, it makes no difference to God. You understand? Whether it was of good intent or bad intent, it doesn't matter to God. It's just not right. And so God's going to fix it because it's just not right. That's why we need a holy God. We need a righteous God. We need one that is just. Because, again, church, he's only going to do what's right. He's not going to, you know, hey, let's see who does and does. This right here should show you and tell you that, listen, the righteous God is for everybody. No matter where you find yourself in life, whatever you position or anybody else that's in your life, he's still for them. And he still will empty out their earth. I think it was it Jeremiah? I think it was Jeremiah. God told him, he said, hey, girdle yourself with this loin and don't get it wet. And again, it's a picture to show us. But Judah, and he at that time, he was, you know, giving the message to Judah, and Judah wasn't listening, of course. He's like, okay, now go take the girdle. He goes, stick it in the Euphrates. Hide it in the Euphrates. Now go back and get it. And he said, what happened? He said, well, it's marred. Right, it's good for nothing. You see, and that's the church. We become so saturated in the world, we're actually hidden. Like, you can't even find, what's the world and what's the church? I don't know, I'm hidden in the Euphrates, you can't even find it. But we're supposed to be the glory of God, we're supposed to be the apparel of God, we're supposed to cover God. He's like, you're good for nothing, I can't use you, you're saturated in the world, man. We got saturated in the world. We want to try and make heaven taste more like earth. And God's like, no, 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 no. I need earth to taste more like heaven, man. Amen. We get it backwards. We get it backwards. And by the way, when you read that passage in Jeremiah, what does he say? He's like, I'm going to fill you all up. You're going to have your fill of wine. And then when it's filled to the top, you know what he does? He busts them all. The bottle's gone and the wine's gone. Because God will let us have our fill. And so guess what, church? You can't have, it's no more. It's just like the Israelites when they complained about the manna and they wanted quail. You want quail? You'll get quail. They got quail. What happened? They said they got sick. It was up to their nostrils. Like they couldn't take it anymore. If that's what you want. As though God doesn't know. See, that's the craziness. Like, that's the audacity of me. God doesn't know, but I do know. And this is what I need, or this is what I want. Okay. Like, God won't argue with you. You want the quail, Phil? I'll give you the quail. Until I'm sick of it. And I say, Lord, please, no more quail. No more quail, Lord. He empties me. I'm filled with the wrong stuff. You got to see this again. He's a loving God. He's doing this through the eyes of love. And what happens when we find ourselves in this situation? Well, let's go down to, I'll pick it up in verse 10. The city of confusion is broken down. Every house is shut up, and no man can come in. My house is all messed up, and I don't want anybody in. Because again, I don't understand. I don't understand the love of Christ. And there's this confusion in my life because I filled it up with everything other than God, other than righteousness. There is a crying for wine in the streets. All joy is darkened, and myrrh of the land is gone. I got nothing to rejoice about. I'm not even happy. I filled myself up with all this quail, and now I'm miserable. What happened? I thought I'd be happy. You ever find yourself in that situation? You're asking God, you want this, you want this, you want this. You finally get it because you thought for sure you'd be happy. You got it? I'm miserable. I'm not happy. What in the world happened? God, that's what you want? That's what you shall have. But it wasn't the will of God. What is God's will? What does he want from my life? It's simple, church. He wants the empty vessel. He wants the cup that says, hey, fill me up. Okay, I'll fill you up. But when I say, no room, I got cups fine. Can I put a topper on that for you, Phil? Nope. Not another drop, Lord. Okay. Have it your way. Again, you got to see this, though, through love. It's through love. Because ultimately, then, you do come, at least for me, you realize I'm a knucklehead, number one. And number two, he knows what's best. He knows what's best. I don't. Even though I think I know, and even though I think I get it figured out, and sometimes church, even still to this day, I think I get things figured out. And he's like, no, you really don't. All right, we'll just dump this out and give me a fresh one, Lord. He gives me a fresh one. And the city is left desolation, and the gates are smitten with destruction. And that's our city. It's the soul of man. It's our lifestyle. It's a wreck. And my gates, you ain't getting in my gates. Why? Because it's just filled with nothing but destruction. I think it's, isn't it Proverbs that says that the one that has no control over his spirit is like a broken down city with no walls? Because the spirit man doesn't rule. When the spirit man doesn't rule, it's gonna make a mess in my life. It's gonna make a mess in my life, and then my gates are just not gonna work right. I'm just broken down, and I don't have any walls. And I think it's Ezra that actually talked about Ezra that when he came in and they were rebuilding Jerusalem. Ezra chapter 9, verse 9. For we are bondmen, yet our God hath not forsaken us in our bondage. There you go. Right there is a promise you can hold on to. God did not forsake me in my bondage? No. You mean when I thought I was trapped and there was no way out? Yeah, he didn't forsake you. Even though I made the wrong choice, and even though I told him I didn't want no more, yeah, I'm still not going to forsake you because you're my child and I love you. I know you're going to do some silly things and foolish things and make some foolish decisions, but I'm not going to forsake you. You'll learn from it, but I will not forsake you. Amen. But he hath extended mercy unto us in the sight of the king of Persia to give us a reviving. You mean he's sending revival? You mean I thought I had nothing to live for? Now all of a sudden there's revival in my life? There's this spark, this hope, there's something more? Can that happen? Man, God is good. But that's exactly what he is saying here. To set up the house of our God and to repair the desolation thereof and to give us a wall in Judah and in Jerusalem. I'm going to give you a spark. I'm going to give you a hope. We're going to rebuild this thing, okay? But here, this time, what are we going to do? He tells you, I'm going to repair it. I know I made a mess of it. I know I mucked it up. I know I said and did things I shouldn't have done. But God says it's okay. I'm going to have mercy on you. I didn't forsake you. And better than that, I'm going to give you mercy. And then I'm going to send you in to repair this thing. And he repairs the wall. You see, church, we do need walls. Now, walls, you can see them in the negative context, like the walls of Jericho. That is a negative context. That is the flesh of man. It's got to come down. Because until that comes down, I believe Jericho means the fragrant place, right? You don't get to the fragrant place until what? Until the stupid walls come down. But then I need a new set of walls. He gives us two here. He talks about Judah and Jerusalem. What protects your city? Because you do got to protect the city. The city would be protected, right? There was walls. Even there were walls around Jerusalem. You do have to protect the city. How do you protect the city? With praise and with peace. That's how you protect the city. That's not a broken down city. But the minute I don't praise God, and the minute I don't praise you, guess what? Now I'm like that broken down city that's got no walls. Because I didn't let the spirit man rule. I let my natural man rule. You understand? How do you protect the city? How do you protect it? I protect it through praise and through peace. No matter where I find myself in life, I praise God and I praise you. Well, I can praise God, Pastor, but I'm not sure about praising for so-and-so. Right, you got a broken down system. He needs to empty your earth. Because you can't praise people. Because church, we can praise God. We know he's above it all, and we know he's got the big bug zapper, and he can zap us at any moment. You know, he's just going to zap Ken. Everyone else is fine. But man, we won't choke down. We'll choke all day before we praise somebody else. Why is that? Because I don't think we're filled with the love of Christ yet. You want to protect the city? Praise. Praise God and praise people. Praise comes first. And then what? Then peace. Because the truth is, if I praise you, it's a lot easier for me to be at peace with you. Now, if I curse you, what shot do I got at being at peace with you? You understand what I'm saying? Once again, God actually does know what he's doing. Shocking, right? It's amazing. But if I'll praise you, then I can be at peace with you. Don't try and justify why you got to praise them. Just do it because God said so. Isn't that just sometimes a good enough reason? I mean, I need more answers, Lord. Was that last week with Pastor Mike asking all the questions? Sure. Ask God the questions, but he will, when it's asked and answered, we're not satisfied. We want more answers. It's okay. Many of the great men of the Bible would do that, right? Gideon. Lord, if I put the fleece out and it's dry, then I'll know it's you. Okay, yeah, it's dry. Well, what I really meant was if the fleece is wet and the world, everything else is dry, then I'll know it's you. Okay. Right? We do the same thing. We do the same thing. Listen, he'll tell you a million times. His answer won't change, though. That's our problem. I want a different answer. What answer do I want? My answer. Right, Phil, that's what I'm trying to empty the earth out of. Your stinking answers, they're no good. I got a bucket full of your answers. They're no good. It's okay. We all got them. We all got them. The only way you're going to protect that city? Praise and peace. Praise and peace, church. That's what we got to be doing, amen? Verse 16. From the uttermost part of the earth, we have heard songs, even glory to righteousness. But I said, my leanness, woe unto me. The treacherous dealers have dealt treacherously. Yea, the treacherous dealers have dealt very treacherously. Oh, church, we heard. From the uttermost parts of the earth, we have heard songs of glory. And we know he's righteous. But, this is a bad but. But, my leanness, treacherous all around me. So that's a problem, church. We heard of the songs. Are you going to live in them songs? Or are you just going to hear about them? Right? We've heard about the glory of God. We heard about his power and his majesty. We heard about Calvary. Great. Why don't you try living it? Listen, there's lots that hear. But until you actually see it and produce it, it really doesn't mean anything. I think it's also Ephesians that says that, that we are to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, and that we are filled with the fullness of God. Do you know the love of Christ? Because it's got to pass knowledge. How do you pass knowledge? How do you get past knowledge? Well, church, you've got to experience the love of Christ. You have to experience my love of Christ in you. That's how you get past it. I know you know about it. Can you get past the knowing? The whole world knows about it. Can we get past the knowing? And do what? Experience it. Can I experience the love of Christ that's in you? I can if I praise you and I have peace. But if I curse you and tell you you're not welcome at my Thanksgiving table, then no. Now you're just like the unclean spirit that finds the empty house. And he goes and gets seven more, and your state is worse than the first place. We heard. And what is the leanness and what is this treacherous church? I just see this is what he's actually emptying the earth out of. The leanness, it's the pity. It's life's not treating me fair. No, just the pastor. You guys are all being treated fairly. Not fair. That's the leanness. And the treacherous, it's just jealousy, man. Isn't that, it's the crazy dichotomy that we have in our life, right? I want you to feel sorry for me for whatever moments and this and that. And then I'll turn around and I'll be jealous of you for whatever. We're never satisfied. It doesn't matter whether you look at me and you don't feel sorry or whether I look at you and I say, I want that. Like, nothing satisfies, man. That's why he's got to empty out my earth. It's filled with stupidness. Now, church is in there. I got a little bit of church mixed in with all of this. But I say, whoa, my leanness. And the treachery, well, it's all around. Jealousy. Man, jealousy will wreak havoc. And the truth is, church, I don't even think at times we understand that it's actually jealousy that it's at work in our life. Jealousy is just another form of pride. It's just another form of greed. It's all mixed together, church. It's all mixed in. We think we can sort it out. Oh, I'm not jealous. It's all mixed, church. It's all a mixture. It's the picture of Joseph and his brothers, right? They wanted to kill him. Why? Because they were jealous of him. Why? Because he lived a life different. Because he lived a life that wasn't filled with the world. It wasn't saturated in the world. It was different, man. It was set out to God, man. He was just a happy dude. He just loved life. You read through that whole thing. When was he miserable? Never. He was always happy. Hey, here comes the whistler. Here comes the dreamer, right? He was, hoo-hoo. I'm sure, what are you happy about? You ever see that? You get mad at someone because, what are you happy about? I'm miserable. I want you to be miserable with me. Take that whistling and get out of here. No, just me. You guys are good. That's who Joseph was. Isn't that how we're supposed to live our life? Like, why can't we grab onto that? But the brothers couldn't. And so they, you know, the story. Actually says they cast him in an empty pit. And then good old brother Judah. Judah. What does Judah say? What's the point of killing him? Greed set in. We can sell him. Make a profit. Imagine that. I don't know what's worse. Wanting to kill you or selling you to make, because you want to make a few bucks off of me. I might want the gun. I don't know. I don't know. What's worse? I don't know. And of course, they sell him. He's nothing to them. We do that with with Christ. We do that with our own lives. Why? Because we'll look at the world and say, well, surely that's better, or surely, you know, we just get jealous over stupid stuff. But yeah, but you have Christ. What should we be jealous for? You have Christ. And the truth is, you can't be filled without him. I think it's the Ephesians 1, the last verse, that he fills all things. Who does? Christ. Christ. You can't be filled. You can't be satisfied without him. You understand? What are we jealous for? Why is that? Because we're silly. We just don't understand. We don't understand God. We don't understand his word. Fear and the pit and the snare are upon all the inhabitants of the earth. We step into our own trap. The minute I let pity come into my life, the minute I let jealousy come into my life, or greed, or unfair, the minute you have that thought race across your head, that's not fair. You just walked into your own pit. Didn't even know it. Church, I couldn't tell you how many times I have thought that. I got to say, Lord, empty that out, man. Because that's not how you want me to live. That's not how you want me. That's the broken down city. And it shall come to pass that he who fleeth from the noise of the fear shall fall into the pit. And he that cometh up out of the midst of the pit shall be taken from the snare. For the windows from on high are open, and the foundations of the earth do shake. Why does this happen? Why do I keep walking into the trap? Like, if you get out of one trap, that's what he's telling you. You get out of the pit, you're going to get the snare. It doesn't matter. You're not getting away, is what he's telling you. Why? Because the windows from on high were open. Who released this? God. Because once again, he's got to catch you to stop you, because he's not going to let you live like that. As I'm saying, you got to see this through the love of God. This is not a bad thing, church. It's emptying me of all this stupid stuff in my head, whether it's religion, whether it's just the thoughts of the world, because that's just the way the life works. I mean, how many times have you heard that? That's just the way life works. No, it's not. It's a lie. Christ is all and fills all. That is how life works. Amen. Life works when we praise and keep peace. That is how life works. Who's preaching that message? Praise. What if we praised our president? What if we praised him? What if we praised President Biden? Thank you for choosing to serve. They're crucifying the guy because he went over some dude's house for Thanksgiving. Well, he's not allowed to celebrate Thanksgiving and they have money. I don't even know. It's the stupidity of it. Why can't we just praise for Thanksgiving? I don't know, church. I think that's what God would have us to do. But it says we flee from the noise. What's the noise? It's our own noisy emotions, church. That's why we're running. We flee from the noise. It's just a noise between our ears, man. And sometimes that noise is so loud, right? No matter what you do, you can't even hold a thought. It's so noisy up in there. No, just me? Like, you got that thing cranked up on 10. The whole world might not know it, but that thing is so loud, you can't hear anything anybody is saying, including God. Including God. Man, the emotions, they'll get them. We can crank them suckers up to 10 real fast, can't we? You don't hear nobody. And then what do? You run. And you just get trapped in a pit. You're trapped in a snare. You don't even realize it, man. You're stuck in it, and you can't get out. You need God to come along and